Jesus, we thank you that we get to spend time just focusing on the beauty of who you are, the beauty of your love, the beauty of your sacrifice, Jesus. And I pray this morning, God, that this recenters us and refocuses us, God, after probably a busy week. May we see you more clearly, Jesus, and may we be changed by it.
Beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
On his shoulders, ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought.
No power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. Have paid my ransom.
Why should I?
Why should I gain? Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know.
His wounds have paid my ransom.
Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him. When they came to a place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross. And the criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." And the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. The crowd watched and the leaders scoffed. "He saved others," they said. "Let him save himself if he is really God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers mocked him too, by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." A sign was fastened above him with these words, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals hanging beside him scoffed, "So you're the Messiah, are you? Prove it by saving yourself, and us too while you're at it." But the other criminal protested, "Don't you fear God even when you have been sentenced to die? We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man hasn't done anything wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus replied, I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. By this time, it was about noon, and darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. The light from the sun was gone. And suddenly, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn down the middle. Then Jesus shouted, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. And with those words, he breathed his last.
Friends and family, we are gathered here today to remember the life and grieve the death of Jesus of Nazareth. In a space like this, in a community like this, in a gathering like this, there are obvious and would be varying degrees to which we knew and loved him. For some of us, it's only been in passing, in hearing about him, in being familiar with some of his teaching, his life, his love, and his legacy, knowing he was unique, but perhaps we never really fully understand why or how. And for others, it's been a longer journey on the path, on the road of listening, of learning, walking, hearing, growing, loving, following, and trusting in him and what he said, and realizing that through him, the world really is or should have been knit together through love. And this is indeed what he exemplified. God is love. Jesus was love incarnate. Indeed, this holds the world and us together. Even now, in the desperate face of grief and loss, may we hold to the truth that God is love, even when it doesn't seem like it. Jesus was born into humility in unassuming terms and ways. In the country, in Nazareth, in Galilee, to an unassuming family of nobodies, albeit through extraordinary, mysterious circumstances. He was loved by his brothers and sisters. He was loved by his father. He was loved by his mother, all of whom we grieve alongside and grieve alongside us today as we remember him together. Jesus grew up learning how to build and create with his hands, to breathe life and creativity energy into the inanimate and to infuse it with new hope in creation. He also showed the remarkable ability to learn, to pick things up, to teach, to think, and to inspire, all of which he did in, through, and with us. Even at an early age, he pointed us to a richer understanding of the character of God, who he is, his grace and mercy that is unflinching, unrelenting, and unfailing. Because God is love, Jesus made that clear and plain. If you've known him well, you know that he lived his life partnered and connected with the most marginalized, impoverished people of the world, the outsiders, in the hopes that others, us included, would recognize that this truly is where the heart of God always has been, with people in pain, with people in loss, with people in suffering, and with people in need of hope. And so indeed, this is our collective experience with him as well. We need and cling, even now, to hope. Jesus also wasn't shy about calling out injustice, calling out inequity, calling out the dangers and pollution of religion, calling out the evils of the love of money, the pollution and cancer of power, the draw of empire, and he called us to reject it, to lay it down, instead to embody grace and to have eyes for each other as image bearers of the divine, to have eyes for each other, brothers and sisters, instead of eyes for selfishness and individualism. Jesus taught us about the depths of God's love made plain in him. He showed us the arms wide invitation of the divine, the forgiveness and mercy extended to us by God in the hopes that we would do the same with each other. We all know and can attest that he lived generously, graciously, mercifully, passionately, transparently, intentionally, mysteriously, and other-centeredly. He gave and forgave much. He was willing to set aside agenda and accomplishment for bread and wine and fellowship, for dinner and dancing, for connection and conversation and laughter. And this is what I remember most about him. In his last days, he knew that some weren't hearing, understanding, listening, or willing to do anything about it. He knew this and said that he would be taken, tried, and hurt by those that he had always been intending to help. And in the end, tragically, his words came true. And so here we are gathered today for that reason, to remember and to grieve. What happened to Jesus was surely not justice, but cruelty at the hands of humanity. A life taken too soon, a movement of love seemingly scattered at the hands of merciless violence that too often has encompassed the worst of who we are, the worst of humanity. And in that, it's easy to be overwhelmed and even angry in this moment. And so, brothers and sisters, in this moment, as we're gathered together as spiritual family, may we take comfort and care in the words that he has left us with. As he said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you and for me? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am, and you know the way to where I am going. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. If you'd really known me, you would know who my Father is, and from now on you do know him and you have seen him. The words I speak are not my own, but my Father who lives in me does his work through me. Just believe. Believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe because of the work you have seen me do. Brothers and sisters, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father. So you can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it, so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. If you love me, obey my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit, who will lead you into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him, but you know him because he lives with you now and later will dwell within you. So know that I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. When I'm raised to life again, you will know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you." And so on this day of our grieving, of darkness, even doubt, we cling to his memory, to hope, and we cling to his words as we comfort each other. Amen.
O Lord, here we are standing in a place of remembrance, of grief, of confusion, and more than anything, we feel our deep need for you. Holy Father, be with us as we remember and reflect and pray through the steps to the cross. We know that the way of sin, the way of the world, leads to death. We feel it in our bodies. We see it in every corner of our world. We watch Jesus, our Lord and Savior, walk through death with quiet dignity, with honesty and grace. Show us, God, how to hold the space of death with courage, how to notice the parts and places in ourselves that need to die in order to make room for all that you want to do in us and through us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we saw Jesus, our teacher on the way, take up his cross. Sometimes the call you place on our lives feels like more than we can bear. We are tempted to shrink away from the challenges and hardships on our path. We wonder if we can make it up the hill through the places of death and lessening that you have called us to. Jesus carried his own cross with strength and grace, undeterred by the insults hurled along the way. As we look to how we will carry on, God, show us how to carry these heavy burdens. Teach us what it means to follow you, no matter the cost. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we go, Lord, we are so very afraid of failing. We are afraid of not being seen as strong or able to manage everything that has been given to us to do and to hold. Somehow, the expectations have become so high that there is no place for weakness, for vulnerability, for needing help. We saw how Jesus fell on his way to Calvary, the Son of Man, the one who was promised, Lord. We saw him stumble and fall under the weight of a cross. God, teach us not to despise our humanity. Teach us to accept our places of need and lack as an opportunity to point to who you are. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we saw how the life of Jesus was shaped by his mother. We remember Mary's prayer, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be according to your word." And we notice the cost of this full surrender to you. How can we continue to trust you here? We need your goodness and your strength to know how to release the things that you've given us. Sometimes, Father, this is the deepest pain of all. Teach us how to bear this pain when we need to. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Along the way, Father, we need help as we go. We need companions to help shoulder our burdens when they become too heavy. We saw Simon of Cyrene step in to carry the cross for Jesus. We are often ashamed to ask for what we need, or perhaps to receive help when it's given. As we walk this path together, forgive us for our proud self-sufficiencies and for all the ways in which they wall us off from you and from each other. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we saw the woman who wiped the face of Jesus, who was moved to offer the one small thing she could give in this moment of pain. She couldn't save our Lord or stop what was happening, but she could offer kindness along the way. She saw the blood and sweat pouring down Jesus' face, and her response, so simple, was also so needed, so true, and so full of worship. Would we have had the courage, Lord, to step out of safety into the crowd and expose ourselves to help a stranger? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, when Jesus fell again, we felt our own weakness and lack and were embarrassed. We want to explain it away. We want to blame someone else or deny what happened. But even in these moments of weakness, God, where Jesus was beaten, betrayed, bloodied, there was still something strong. His commitment to you, Father, never wavered. In his example, God, we see how falling is not the same as failing. Teach us, Lord, how to rise again with dignity and continue following in your way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, there is so much grief here. We don't know what to do with it. Like the women of Jerusalem, our grieving is often full of melodrama, and it misses the point. We want to hold space for true grief, something so deep it can only be endured. Help us, God, to hold well the truth of the sorrow that comes as an unexpected part of our walk with you. Unexpected, but repeated, and we know that you're there with us. Help us as we touch our own humanity and lead us to repentance. May we know the comfort you promise to those who truly mourn. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, Jesus fell again and we're undone. When will this be over? When will you bring salvation? When will you rescue him and us? We want it to be finished. We want restoration and redemption to be complete. But God, we're beginning to see how falling and getting up again is always a part of how we go with you. Help us to not be overcome with despair when the way is too hard. Be near, God. Be near in these places of heaviness, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we watched as they stripped Jesus of his garments. It was too hard, too horrible to witness the complete loss of his dignity. It's more than we can bear. And we feel aware of how much energy we spend protecting ourselves from this kind of nakedness. God, help us see that our identity is found only in you. Even when everything else is stripped away, you are still here, and we are still yours. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And then, O Lord, the time came. Jesus was nailed to the cross. The one who would save us, the one in whom we put all our hope, was crucified before our very eyes, and he was silent before his accusers. Sometimes, God, there are no words. We behold the Lamb of God beaten and abused, blessed and broken. And Lord, there is nothing here but such deep sorrow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, how did Jesus know when it was time to release his life into your hands? We confess that we don't always know when to let go. We do not lay our lives down willingly, and so they have to be wrenched from us, and it hurts even more. God, teach us to let go when it's time. Teach us to truly live in complete surrender to you. Show us how to do what we do not yet know how to do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We watched in silence as Jesus' body was taken down, wrapped in linen cloth and prepared for burial. God, in this moment, we feel the full depth of the loss of Jesus. He loved us with his whole life, and we are lost without him. We are overcome. We are heartbroken. We need you, God. We need you in this place of death. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We followed those who carried Jesus' body to the tomb, and we waited in silence as his body was laid there and the tomb was sealed. We would never have wished it to come to this, yet we call these moments holy as we hold you. Holy the tending, holy the winding, holy the leaving as in the living. Holy the silence, holy the stillness, holy the turning and returning to earth. Blessed is the one who came in the name. Blessed is the one emptied for us. Blessed is the one wearing the shroud. Holy is the waiting, holy the grieving. Holy the shadows and the gathering night. Holy is the darkness. Holy the hours. Holy the hope turning toward light. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.